Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. We did just have a little shorter meditation this morning so we could have enough time for the talk and also for any discussion afterwards. But before I begin, I do want to express my personal gratitude to all the people who get here early, who clean, who set up, who greet, who do the flowers, make the tea, all those things, which makes it so easy for the rest of us just to show up and do this. So I want to thank everybody, people behind the scenes who do all the work kind of thing. I've had several requests to talk about work. It seems as if work and issues at work is a problem for people. And so since we practice engaged Buddhism, which is a Buddhism that is engaged in all aspects of life, not just in the meditation hall, I think it's important that we deal directly with the issue of work and how do we practice at work. And just to show that this is not a new issue, I am reading here from an anthology called The Roaring Stream, a New Zen Reader. It's a compilation of kind of teachings, letters, poems from many masters in the Zen tradition in China and Japan. And what I'm reading from here is there was a great Japanese Zen master called Hakuin, who lived and taught, his dates are 1685 to 1768, so not all that many years ago. And in this collection, there is a letter that he wrote to Lord Nabashima. And I would imagine this was in reply to a letter that he had received. Again, this is, for those of you who do not remember, there was a time before emails when people did things like write letters by hand in ancient times. So this is how they used to have to communicate in those days. So if Hakuin had students who weren't right living around him, the way they would communicate with him, they would write him letters, and obviously he would spend a good part of his day responding. So I would imagine by Hakuin's response, that Lord Nabashima was saying something that many people say. I hear it all the time, which is what? You know, I'd love to practice more, but, my work, my activities just get in the way. It's so many things to do, so busy. You know, I just can't practice, you know. So obviously, the Lord Nabashima wrote one of these kinds of letters. So this is how Hakuin replied, and then we'll discuss it. Hakuin says, "Do not say that worldly affairs and precious of business leave you no time to study Zen, or we could under a master, and that the confusions of daily life make it difficult for you to continue in your meditation." Does this sound familiar? There seems to be a problem with the speaker or me. Thank you. Good. So again, does that sound familiar? Too many pressures, too many affairs, no time to practice, and the confusions of daily life make it difficult to practice. Right, so I would imagine many people here have heard themselves say the same thing. "Everyone must realize," as Hakuin continuing, "everyone must realize that for the true practitioner, there are no worldly cares or worries." And then he goes on to say, "Supposing someone accidentally drops two or three gold coins in a crowded street, swarming with people, do they forget about the money because all eyes are upon them? Do they stop looking for it because it will create a disturbance? Most people will push others out of the way, not resting until they get their money back into their own hands. are not people who neglect the study of Zen, meditation, because the press of mundane circumstance is too severe, or stop their meditation because they are troubled by worldly affair, putting more value on one or two pieces of gold than on the unsurpassed mysterious way of the Buddhists. A person who concentrates solely on meditation amid the press and worries of everyday life will be like the person who dropped the gold coins and devotes themselves to seeking them. Who would not rejoice in such a person? And then he quotes a master who says, or it must have been a poem, but it was a great master too. He wrote, "See the horses competing at the Kamo race grounds. Back and forth they run. Yet this is sitting in meditation." And then he quotes another master who explained it this way. "Don't read the teachings, practice meditation. Don't take up the broom, practice meditation. Don't plant the tea seeds, practice meditation. Don't ride a horse, practice meditation. This is the true attitude of a practitioner." And then he quotes someone else who says, "The person who practices meditation without interruption, even though they may be in a street teeming with violence and murder, even though they may enter a room filled with wailing and mourning, even though they attend wrestling matches in the theater, even though they are present at musical and dance performances, is not distracted or troubled by the minutiae of life, but conscientiously fixes their mind on their practice, proceeds single-mindedly, and does not lose ground." So this is the mid 1700s, 1819. So we're 250 years ago. So for those of us who think, nobody understands what we have to deal with in our life, I just wanted to begin with understanding that we are not the first, and that this is a common problem. Okay, but it is clear from what Master Hakuin Zenji says that we have no excuse, even though we are full of excuses, we might say. So, many people have problems at work. Many people, they get up in the morning, they do their practice, they go out the door, they go to work, and whatever intentions, aspirations, whatever practice they have, forgotten. And just work whirls them around. And they feel stressed, they feel pressured, all kind of emotional things going on, people. Right? Certain people, just disturb them unmercifully. And, at the end of the day, they're all just whacked out. Right? Sergio's nodding his head. Right. And so it is important to understand, if that is the case, we do have a significant problem, because we do spend a significant part of our life at work. And when I say work, it could be work, school, volunteer activities, whatever, unless we are so independently wealthy, or else unless we are have a nice retirement and we just kind of float about this world, most of us live in the world of activity. So that's what we're talking about. Now, so we acknowledge that we have a problem here. And most of us, we're looking for the solution here. But I would say that is a mistake. You may have a problem here, but the cause of it may be elsewhere. And if we don't, we're looking for the fix here. But I want to begin by suggesting to you that the fix may be over here. Right? And so that is why all our efforts to fix it here don't seem to work, because because we haven't really looked what is the cause of my problem. And I think we get a little flavor with Hakuin's response, right? Which again is what? what is your aspiration in this life? Right? What is our intention every day? If that's, I'm kind of looking at that's over here. See, if that's not clear, then it is very easily to get totally turned around over here. Is that clear? And we think the problem is here. But the problem we're getting turned around is because we're not clear over here. When we're clear over here, then we know how to deal with this and we understand this better. When we're not clear about this and we have no understanding of what this is about, then we get turned. And the understanding that we want to generate here and the practice that we want to generate here has to do with this. Okay, now, what is this? Right. Well, again, what am I doing here? And what am I doing every day? Right. For example, let's say you want to cultivate mindfulness. For example, this is a Florida community of mindfulness, so one of the things we might be cultivating is what? Mindfulness. The capacity to be present. Right? So, is that an intention of my life? To lead a more mindful life? To be more in the present? Right? That could be one thing. Perhaps we have another kind of aspiration. Maybe we want to be a kinder human being. How about that one? Right? Maybe we want to be a less egocentric human being. Right? We don't want to always be. It's always about me. Everything's about me. Everything I encounter in life, I'm always making it about me. Right? So maybe I want to, I see that a bigger purpose in my life is to be more selfless, less egocentric, less full of ego, less full of self, be a kinder human being, a more compassionate human being, a more mindful human being, a more caring human being, a more patient human being, right? A more giving human being, a more hoping human being. Does everybody get the drift? Right? Now, probably everybody in here would probably say, yeah, that is the kind of person I want to be, right? And yet, what happens? If we look at our activity during the day, we may not recognize that the person who says he or she has these intentions and the person who goes around carrying on their activities a day is not the same person. Right? And then we come home at night and we realize, once again, same old, same old. Right? Then you regroup. Maybe read your Dharma books at night, get back on track, get up in the morning, do your meditation, and then get totally turned around once again. And we think the problem is here, but the problem is here. This is not very strong. This is quite weak. It so easily gets turned around. It gets easily so blown away. Right? So, if we want the solution to this, we need to look here. Am I, when I go out the door in the day, am I clear that my purpose today is to cultivate mindfulness, to be present? And that throughout the day, that is very much in my mind. When I go out the door in the morning, and am I very clear? May I be of benefit to people today? May I be helpful to people today? May I be kind? May I be understanding, right? But that's, you see, you may have a job or you may have a task. Those are the things you do, right? But your spiritual practice, your meditative practice is all about what? The kind of person you want to be. The kind of person who's doing all that. But we don't have that. We just become doers. And we're lost in the world of doing. And it's always about the world of what I'm doing. So everything else, the activities of the world, the people around you, are either what? They're either people who you think are helping you do what you want to do, Or what? Or they're getting in the way. And when people get in the way of what we want to do, what do we like it? No, we don't like it. We get frustrated. We get irritated. We get disappointed. Right? We get all those kinds of reaction. We also, even though in our saner moments, we would say, I want to be a happy person. For starters, yeah, I want to be a happy person. I want to have a peaceful mind. I want to have good relations with people. Right? So again, that's our intention. But then we act as if every situation we're in is like a life or death situation. You know? It's like, God, if I don't get my to-do list done, or if I don't get this project done on time, what, the world's going to come to an end? I mean, we act as if we are the most important person in the world, and everything we do is the most important person. And we often exist in systems that have that same mentality. It's crazy. It is crazy. And if we want to be insane, we will go along with it. But if we don't want to be insane, we will see it for what it is. If that is where we are working or acting, we will participate in that, but we don't get caught up in that mentality. You know, it's a mentality that is fed by ignorance. There's a kind of grandiosity, personal and institutional, about you know what we're doing is so important, right? And these deadlines we set and all these things, they got to, you know, it's funny, when I was in my work life and I was a therapist in Naples, I had many clients like that. They thought they were God's gift to the world, and that what they were doing was the most important thing in the world. And, they get so pressured and so stressed by their life. And I said, you know, if you had a heart attack today, would you get this thing done? Probably not, they'd say. Yeah, you'd be in the hospital. What would happen? You know, so if you had a heart attack and you were in the cardiac ICU, what would happen? You know, to all these things that were so weighing on you that had to get done, what would happen? Well, they'd either be postponed, or somebody else would do them, or, you know, it's like life would go on, right? Life would go on. But people are so crazy, they'd rather have the heart attack. You know, that's the only way they'll stop, right? You know, they got to have the heart attack or the breakdown or the alcoholism or whatever they do to deal with their stress and their pressure. You know, they'll let that thing spin out of control rather than seeing the insanity of what they're involved in. I mean, we have to have values. We have to see things in perspective. And we have to not go along with the herd if the whole herd is saying what? This is the most important thing in the world, and it's all got to get done on this time frame. And, you know, nobody goes, well, what happens if it's not done? Right? I mean, what if it's not finished by Friday? Doesn't Monday exist? Tuesday? Well, I mean, you know, but people create these deadlines, and everybody buys into it. It's like a mass psychosis. Right? And then something comes up, and all of a sudden it doesn't get done, and all of a sudden somehow life continues on. Right? I mean, has life ever ended when a deadline has not been met? I don't know. That's a question. Because maybe I'm wrong. Right? I mean, maybe the world does come to an end, or tragic things happen. And yet, you know, we live in a culture where people carry their stress. I mean, stress and pressure is like normal. People talk about, oh yeah, a lot of stress, a lot of pressure. Like stress or pressure is something that exists. Right? I mean, this has an existence, right? Can you see it? This is a cup. It exists because we can see it. Right? Can anybody show me their stress or pressure? Everybody talks about, I mean, if people talk about a cup, I could at least show them a cup. Right? If they talk about flowers, I can show them flowers. If people talk about the book, I can show them the book. Can you show me, can anybody show me the stress and pressure that they feel? If it's real, it has to exist, right? Why can't we show it to anybody? Because it's a fabrication of our own minds. And you will have time to discuss this in a few minutes. You're welcome to totally disagree with me. Okay? So therefore, we need a clear sense of what I'm doing in this life. We need a clear appraisal and view of what this life is about, what's important, what's not important, what my values are, and right? So before I enter this world of activity, I know who I am and I know how I want to be when I enter this. Again, if you do not know that, this will spin you. This will spin you because this is where this is a certain kind of energy. And that in these days it is reinforced by everybody around you. So if you're not clear, grounded, right, you will get swept into that. Is that clear? So that's what I'm saying. We see the problem here and we're always looking for solutions here. But the problem's over here. Okay. So again, many people, and maybe some people in this room, when they wake up in the morning, what's the first thing in their minds? What? Beside coffee, yeah. And coffee often just feeds. But what do people these days, their minds wake up in the morning and what? What's in their minds? What do I got to do today, right? Right? The to-do list. Like, that's the most important thing today. I mean, there it is right there, right? It's not like, you know, it's another day. I'm alive. I'm breathing. Right? The sky is up there. You know, the birds are singing, maybe. You know, there's coffee awaiting. You know what I mean? We're not human, right? We are already, you know, doing. And often that to-do list is often something that, what, does that produce ease and well-being in you as you go over your to-do list for the day? Right? No. It produces what? I mean, you're
stress.
So you're not even awake in this world conscious for 10, 15 minutes when already you have picked up your stress from yesterday and you've immediately manufactured it, fabricated it, right? And this is where I'm starting my day. Can you see? It's only going to get worse. I mean, can you see how this is not mystical? This is not esoteric. This is just logic. Right? And this shows us what's most important. We can say, you know, I'm a spiritual person and I practice this and that, but that's not true. We just say that, right? If we get up every morning and the only thing on our mind is my to-do list and I'm already in pressure, I'm stressed, that's telling us really where my mind is. You know, where our mind is where we're at, right? We can call ourselves anything. But when we look at actually what we're doing, that reveals the truth of who we are. Not in the deepest sense, but in the active sense. So it begins right there, you know. No matter what the activity of the day is, we should wake up in the morning with ease and notice that we're alive. 24 new hours. To be alive. People in my life are alive. Right? It's a sense of connection with the good things in your life. Right? And you should get out of bed and go into your bathroom in mindfulness. Right? And do your morning wash up and this and that. And go into the kitchen and get your tea and coffee and enjoy that. And then we should spend some time just meditating. You know, so we're quieting, calming, grounding the mind. Not just running off. And then we should be clearly setting our intention. This is important. I mean, many people have these big intentions, right? I want to be a more mindful person. I want to be a more compassionate person. Right? We have these big, grandiose kinds of things. But we don't actualize them on a day-to-day, hour-to-hour basis. So they never happen. Well, they happen very, not what we're capable of doing. So it's very important that before we go out into the world of activity, we're really clear what our intention is. In other words, not what you're doing today. How do you want to be today? What kind of person do you want to be today? Which is very different than, you know, how much do I want to do? You know, what do I got to do today? Most people, their day consists of what? What do I need to do? You know, what do I got to do today? But if you're really a person of spiritual practice or anything, our biggest thing is what? What kind of person am I going to be today? How do I want to show up today in life? Because whatever you're doing today is just your to-do list. I mean, even people change jobs all the time, right? Right, you're so involved in work and so stressed and this and that. Everything there is the most important thing in the world. You know, and then you give notice and it's like, who cares what's going on there? Right? I mean, that shows you how important it is. Right? You know, you never give it another thought.
Or you get laid off.
Or you get laid off, which happens, right. But either way, there it is. And you're left with what? What kind of person am I? What kind of mind do I have? You know, the jobs come and go, the activities come and go, but at the end of the day, what really matters to each of us is what kind of person am I? What kind of human being am I? Not what kind of a doer am I? You know, we have reduced our life to being very good at accomplishing our to-do lists. That's our focus, and it gives no pleasure. The only pleasure it gives is what? Checking them off. That gives a little bit of pleasure. Right? At least I got that done. Whew, that feels good. You know, and then the next day we start up all over again. Right? It is kind of insane, isn't it, when you look at it that way. So again, we want to be clear that it doesn't mean that you're not a good employee and you don't do good work and all that good stuff. You do all that, but you understand that you are primarily in this world as a human being, and the reason you are all here is because in your life you want to cultivate a greater sense of being. To be a happier human being, a calmer human being, a more peaceful human being, a more loving human being, a more selfless human being. Is that clear? Isn't that why we're here? Right. So it's very important, because the energy of this world that we live in is so much the other way. Right? Because so much in life is reinforced by how much we're doing. Right? People get together these days and they talk about their to-do list and how much they're doing and how pressured they are and, you know, how they're doing on their to-do list. Right? I mean, that's crazy. Is that what life's about? I mean, at the end of the day, is that really what gives us happiness? No. I mean, in our saner moments, we understand that. So again, it's very important, if we have these overreaching intentions or aspirations about the kind of human being I want to be, that we take that into every day. And we're very clear that we set that intention, and I recommend to my students that they actually spend a few minutes in the morning visualizing themselves in the work situation, being the kind of person they want to be, handling things, so you're already kind of preparing your mind. Or else it's not going to happen. And then what? And then we go out the door and we go to work. And that energy of the way it's done is very strong. So just doing it in the morning is not enough. It has to be reinforced throughout the day. You have to kind of stop, take a moment, check back in with your aspiration, with your values. How am I doing? You know, correct, recorrect, troubleshoot, right? Or else a day will just get away from you. So, and again, it's not like you can't be productive. Just taking moments throughout the day to just stop. Just come back to your breath and touch in with your aspiration. And if you're on target, you've reinforced it. And if you've gotten off target, you bring yourself back to it. That is the only way you're going to change. That's what Hakuin's saying, wherever you are. Remember, he said, don't study, meditate. Don't clean, don't wash, don't work, meditate, meditate. What he's meaning there is whatever you're doing, turn it into meditation. Turn it into practice, right? You know, going through your workday and being very present to whatever you're doing, to whatever you're talking to, whatever you're, you know, in front of you, on the phone. Most people, again, they're doing four things. You know, they're doing this, they're thinking about that, they're anticipating this. You know, it's like no wonder people are stressed. If you want to have a peaceful mind in the midst of activity, do one thing at a time, 100%, and then do the next thing, and the next thing. I mean, you can go through your day handling lots of stuff, but be focused. That's what Hakuin's saying. You know, practice in, even in the midst of activity, which means just be focused, 100% present, absorbed in whatever you're doing, then the next thing, then the next thing, then the next thing. You know, you may do, 10 things in an hour, but if as you're doing each one of those things, your mind is also aware of the other 10, can you see how scattered your mind is? No wonder you feel out of sorts. You know, no wonder people, when they come home, they stop at the bar. The first thing they come home, you know, they go right to the fridge and pull out a beer or get a drink. Why, you know, right? Why is that? Because people's minds are just out of control. Right? Why are they out of control? Because they are out of control. Because we don't know how to use our mind throughout the day. Just deal with one thing at a time. You can have 100 things to do. Just 100 mindful moments. And you will feel differently. Right? Again, desire to be more selfless, desire to be more caring human being with you. And then all of a sudden those jerks at work who are just, causing you to, you know, getting in your way and causing you, you might look at them a little differently and the situation a little differently. Right? Again, what are we cultivating? You know, there may be a culture at work, but what kind of culture are we bringing to work? If you don't have your own personal culture, your own personal values, then you will just get lost in the culture that's presented to you. And we know these days, unfortunately, the workplace is primarily motivated by what? Productivity, right? I mean, that's really what the name of the game. It's not often a very caring or a very attentive to the human side of things. But that doesn't mean that we have to be that way. So, when our practice is this way, and we bring our practice to work. We just had a four-day retreat here in Tampa. Some of you were there. And on the final day of retreat, we deal with, in the final Dharma talk, on the morning the retreat ends, I always deal with, what's next, returning to the world. And what I say to people, I say, because they've been spending a lot of time in the meditation hall the last 4 days, and we have a certain protocol, like here, you know, the way we enter the meditation hall, and, you know, we understand what you know, why we're here and what we're doing while we're here. And a lot of people kind of, when they're coming, like, let's say they're coming today, they know what they're coming for, and they have a certain kind of mindset, and they have a certain way of being in the meditation hall, right? So what I say to people is, go to work as if you're going into the meditation hall. It's as simple as that. You know, when you're going into your office, when you're going into your workplace, wherever you're going, enter it with the same awareness like you're going into the meditation hall. In the meditation hall, we are cultivating mindfulness. We're cultivating wakefulness. We're cultivating awareness. We're cultivating patience, you know what I mean? And the person in front of us, you know, the pace of the walking meditation is not the way we like it. Why don't these people move faster? You know, irritation. We'd like to be in control of the world. Right? But we, hopefully in the meditation hall, we learn to let go, right? To flow a little bit. Again, there's a lot of things when we see work as something that can help us develop. You know, it'll help us strengthen my sense of what my values are. Right? Because it is in, again, the energy in this meditation hall is to support mindfulness. Right? The values that are shared in the Dharma talks are probably congruent with most of our values. Again, when we go to work, that is not the case. That is not what's being supported. So we have to be very conscious about how we support those within ourselves. And because we are often in an environment that is, I was about to say hostile, but it may not be hostile, it just may be not supportive of, but it could be hostile to these kind of values. If that will strengthen us, is that clear? That will strengthen us, and you will find that you are maybe developing at a faster rate than you would if you just hung out in the meditation hall, where it's easy. Right? This is easy. So everybody's quiet and silent. Nice bells going off. Nothing we need to do, right? I mean, this is kind of easy. You know, it's easy to be a good practitioner here. Right? But a real good practitioner is how are we practicing at Publix? How are we practicing at work? How are we practicing in our relationships? I mean, that's the challenge, and that's where we will develop. That's where we will strengthen ourselves. But we have to see it for what it is. We have to see that our work, our school, whatever it is, our relationships, is where, you know, is my meditation hall. This is the place that I practice. You know, I gave a workshop a year or two ago on relationships, and I think I entitled it, you know, relationship as a spiritual path. Many people see their relationships as an obstacle to their spiritual path. It's not like that. We should see if we're in relationships, we should see relationships as our spiritual path. It is the place in which we develop our compassion, our understanding, our capacity to love and to be patient and accepting, right? Where else are you going to develop this? On a desert island? All alone? You know, I mean, people are nuts. right? You know, no. If you want to, if you want to learn how to be a loving, caring, selfless person, you have to do it in relationship to another human being. We'd rather not. Right? Much easier just to do it in our meditative practice. Right? In the Mahayana tradition, it's very common to say things like, you know, may all beings be free of suffering, may all beings be happy. You know, these kind of wonderful wishes very easily said, right? But what people don't realize is if we are generating that for all beings, it actually means the people that we encounter during our day. This is what all beings mean. I want to stress that. This is what it means. It means people. But we are, you know, we love to do our metta, loving kindness meditation, wish happiness for all beings, and then we get pissed off at this one and irritated by this one and couldn't care less about that one. Oh, you mean it's about real human beings? Oh, I never got that one. I mean, everyone I come in contact with, I should be open and compassionate and caring to. Oh, that's a little harder than just generating that altruistic wish. That's easy. We don't get any credit for that, right? I mean, it's nice, it's a good beginning, but if it's not actualized, if it's not lived in the real world with real human beings, it will never develop. It will just stay in an aspiration, a nice aspiration. I mean, it's better than wishing ill will to people and wanting people to suffer and be in pain and, you know. So I mean, having a positive wish for beings is putting our mind in the right direction. But it means something. It's got to be actualized in real life with real people. And then it actually develops, right? You know, to have an aspiration to have a healthy body, well, that's good, isn't it? It's better than having an aspiration to have an unhealthy body, right? It kind of gets us in the right track. But then what? You got to start doing something. You got to change your eating habits. You got to change your sleep habits. You got to change your exercise habits. You know what I mean? You got to do something if you want a healthy body, right? It's not just going to happen because we have that wonderful aspiration. The wonderful aspiration sets us off in a direction, but if we never walk it, we'll never get there. So the aspiration to want to be helpful to people and benefit people and, you know, you don't want people to suffer and all that, but then, you know, are we still causing people to suffer in our actions, right? And when we encounter suffering people, even suffering people who are around us, are we really present to them and caring to them? And so it's, and by the way, some of those suffering beings may be people you work with. They may be people who work for you. They may be people who are your bosses, you know what I mean? I mean, they're found everywhere. We have to begin to see that. Let me one quick thing. So this is some of you are familiar. Actually, we do a retreat every year up at Southern Dharma. It's a 7-day retreat, and for many years, I think 3 years in a row, I taught from this sutra. This is called the Vimalakirti Sutra. It is a very unusual sutra. Usually, is the teachings of the Buddha. Vimalakirti was not the Buddha. Vimalakirti was a layman. So this is very unusual to have a sutra. This is called the Vimalakirti Sutra. Vimalakirti, what is his name? And he was an interesting guy. I mean, I won't go into it, but you can, if you're interested, you can. There are a number of translations. Again, he was a layman. And I'm just reading from this. There's a chapter which kind of introduces him. The sutra is actually like a, it's like a play or something. It's a lot of interesting dialogues and actions. But they introduce him, and I'm just skipping around. His wealth was inexhaustible for the purpose of sustaining the poor and helpless. You see, he had a purpose. He had a lot of wealth, but it was, what was the purpose of it? To sustain the poor and the helpless. He observed a pure morality in order to protect the immoral. He maintained tolerance and self-control in order to reconcile beings who were angry, cruel, violent, brutal. He blazed with energy in order to inspire people who were lazy. He maintained concentration, mindfulness, and meditation in order to sustain the mentally troubled. He attained decisive wisdom in order to sustain the foolish. He wore the white clothes of a layman, yet lived impeccably like a religious person. He had a son, a wife. He seemed to eat and drink, yet always took nourishment from the taste of meditation. He made his appearance at the fields of sports and in casinos, but his aim was always to mature these people who were attached to games and gamblings. In order to be in harmony with people, he associated with elders, with those of middle age, and with the young. Yet always spoke in harmony with the Dharma. He engaged in all sorts of business, yet had no interest in profit or possessions. To train living beings, he would appear at crossroads, on street corners. To protect them, he participated in government. He might have even run for state legislature. But he would have to be very highly developed to do that. To develop children, he visited the schools. To demonstrate the evils of desire, he even entered the brothels. To establish drunkards in correct mindfulness, he entered all the cabarets. He was honored as a businessman among businessmen because he demonstrated the priority of the Dharma. He was honored as the landlord among landlords because he renounced the aggressiveness of ownership. He was honored as the warrior among warriors because he cultivated endurance, determination, fortitude. He was honored as the aristocrat among aristocrats because he suppressed pride, vanity, and arrogance. He was honored as the official among officials because he regulated the functions of government according to the Dharma. He was honored as the prince of princes because he reversed their attachment to royal pleasures and sovereign powers. He was compatible with ordinary people because he appreciated the excellence of ordinary merits. So this is Vimalakirti. And traditionally in Mahayana Buddhism, this sutra and Vimalakirti is a great example to us. Because he was a layman, totally engaged in the world, you could see, and yet he used all the situations of his life to be of benefit to others. And he did, he wasn't, like you said, he could go anywhere, right? And yet was never turned by any of these situations. He was a man who was very awake, and he should be an example to us. So, I have spoken, but perhaps I am off base. Perhaps I don't know the real world. Perhaps I'm just in la-la land. And so I am up for the hard-headed realists in the room to straighten me out. I am open to that. But as well, if there are people, and I would hope you would, if you have real situations that you're not clear about how to deal with, because they do cause you suffering at work or in your activity, please ask them. So let us just have an open discussion now. Please feel free. Don't be shy. If anything's not clear. Oh, maybe I've been wrong today. I was told that people are having issues at work, so I was giving this talk, but maybe I'm the only one who has issues. Yes, Molly.
There was an opportunity for me to, after leaving the tree, to turn my wakefulness towards my work life and observe the fortunate, that I'm very fortunate in that I get to learn from everyday life situations of possible, any situation can come up at any time in life. But I'm seeing this sort of a fortunate opportunity to practice instead of not having gratitude. And it has changed my perspective of conflict. So I see it as something that has been provided for me to have an opportunity to learn and to grow instead of being stuck in that negative drama, stuck in that negative wheel of samsara, instead as an opportunity. And I'm very, grateful for that.
So let me just repeat that for the video and the live streaming. So, because they couldn't hear you. So, in summary, Molly is just sharing that since retreat, she's really noticed that she's able to see situations at work or relationships or other kinds of activity that in the past might have been seeds of conflict or difficulty as really opportunities to change and to deal with things that in the past would have, again, been seen as challenges or obstacles or difficulties or conflicts, but really to see them as opportunities to practice, and there's a greater ease with all the things that arise in her life than in the past. Is that a good summary?
Yes, and the teaching of the wakefulness is creating a habit energy that is very beneficial, because it the habit is to be wakeful, and that has been helping in the moment of whenever a situation arises, it's just an experience, but carrying that wakefulness helps.
Yeah, so again, what she's saying is the capacity to be awake, to be wakeful, to be present, and not lost in the world of distraction and mental projection and all that, or at least to notice when that's going on, is a significant game changer. I think that's what you're saying. You're absolutely right. Thank you, Molly. So Katie, just for the just sharing some again her own experience of her own work situation, and that over time she has really learned that work doesn't have to drive her, and that a lot of the dramas and the melodramas and the stresses and the pressures that used to cause her suffering no longer do, because she takes her practice to work and sees things in perspective and feels good about that. Good. Yes.
I want to ask you, how should we be able to practice mindfulness? So you're saying the example that person that was triggered, so stressed because of once you finish the work in the day, and gets me from that person that's so stressed that has a heart attack because of it. So go to the hospital, and that's okay with having a heart attack. And the people that work with him, and that's okay with him, they have also all this drama because it's also work. There are people that take their job seriously, some people don't take that responsibility of taking care of other people's lives seriously. How do you practice mindfulness in situations like that?
Even more mindful than usual. So the question is, well, I understand all this about work and pressures and stresses and deadlines, but how about if you're really dealing with life or death situations? Again, mindfulness is not a practice. We turned it into something. Mindfulness is the capacity to be 100% absorbed and present to what's going on. I would hope. But if I was having a heart attack and was in the emergency room, that whoever was working with me was 100% present. You know, if they were thinking about, their lunch break or thinking about some drama going on at home, and, you know, I would be a little worried, right? I mean, I would hope that that if I'm in an acute situation, that people who are in that situation are mindful and present, because that's the best kind of care. So mindfulness is not we turn it into a practice. I would say that probably, without even practicing, that people who work in those situations practice mindfulness and absorption just because of the heightened, intensity of the situation, and don't know it. But I would say that's what they're doing. They're 100%. I would imagine firemen, other kinds of people who are dealing, directly with a significant thing are probably 100% absorbed, right? Not thinking about the past or future. And so that's, that's natural. The more the situation is, the more you should be present to it and absorbed and not all over the place. Yeah, I think we should be that way all the time. Now, again, not with that kind of intensity, like in an ER or something, but in a more relaxed way to be present, because that's obviously, that's what we'd want, right?
Right? I'm saying this kind of situation, people who are playing politics, who are giving out communication as the life as the first thing, and you have to deal with that even if you're trying to deal with people that are not doing their best.
Right, so it's...
How can you still be in peace?
Well, so the question is, all right, I got you, but what do you do if you're there and you realize, maybe the institution has other priorities for you than being 100% care, or maybe there are other people around who are, while you're 100% there for the patient, they're talking about lunch or some movie they saw last night, or what they're going to watch on Netflix tonight, or, right? So, yeah. Is it a perfect world? Made up of perfect people? No. The world's a mess. Right? It's as simple as that, right? And people are all over the place doing all kinds of things, right? Some just waste of time, some benign, some quite negative effects. Is that not true? That is the world. So, our job is, as an individual or as a group, is how do we enter this world the way it is and change it? And the way we change it is, if you're, are you, do you work in a medical facility? Okay, so what do you do? Okay, so you're a physician. So, so if you're concerned about something 100% and other people are talking and they ask you about, where you want to go for lunch, you don't respond. You get them to join you. I think it's what Katie said when she said she's not scared to be who she is. You know, please raise the bar, right? But we raise the bar through our own personal integrity, right? I mean, it's like, work. I mean, I'm retired now, and I work here, so it's a little different. But when I was in the workplace and all that, gossip. You go in the lunchroom, everybody's gossiping. Just don't. When people try to talk negatively about somebody, either you don't respond, or you say something positive about the person. I mean, that'll definitely shut them up. Right? I mean, you don't have to. You don't have to join in. That kind of stuff. Did you see what I'm saying? And that's, if you ever become president of the world, then you may have more ability to act on a larger scale and really change things. And maybe hopefully one day that'll happen. There will be people like Vimalakirti or other that are a place of significance who do, live from a very different value system than our current leaders. At least you have you right now, right? And how you want to be in your work and all your relationships, and that's that, you have some degree of control over, right? And that's what you can feel good about. And you can't, there may be things going on around you that you don't feel that good about, but that's, but there are a lot of things in this world that if we thought about, we wouldn't feel good about, would we? That seems to be just what's going on, but there are good things, and you can be one of those. Right? Yeah. Any other? Yes.
You talk about. Oh. Well, thank you very much for everything that you said, because it makes sense to all of us. And I'm very far away from being at that stage where we can really deal with difficult situations and be at ease. We talked about values. That's right. So we have this value here, and however, my company's value is totally different. Right? And as much as I try to reconcile and work within the system, but that is almost impossible for me, at least at this stage that I am, to practice the Dharma I should to change that situation or change the system, because it's very strong. And you said that.
Right. So let me just repeat the question, okay? So the question is, again, Sergio saying, I understand it's about values and all this, but, a lot of these systems, these institutions, have very strong cultures that are not supportive of all and are not, at this point, amenable to any change. And, what do you do? Again, there are lots that you can do. First of all, if you have a choice, you could work there or not work there, if you have a choice. Many people don't have a choice, but that's always a choice, right? But sometimes we don't have a choice because of situation. But again, it's at the end of the day, it's your own integrity. At the end of the day, how do you go about what you do, how you conduct yourself, with personal integrity? And at that point, where your own personal integrity and value system clearly is being compromised, that's good. Good for you in the sense of, this is an opportunity for you to decide what is really of value to you. We all have those decisions. I remember personally, I was in community mental health. I was a director of an outpatient unit, in Florida. back in the late 80s and 90s, with cutback, more and more, they wanted you to do more with less, and more with less, and more of this, and finally I got out. Because I realized, that nobody cares about quality here, And again, it wasn't that people who stayed were bad, but it was just a personal thing for me. So, at a certain point, we have to be at peace with ourselves. you know, I don't, you know, for me that point happened over years of until it finally reached a point, but you know, right? I mean, we all have to deal with that. Yes, and last question.
I just want to say something about the benefit of to-dos.
Can we just say, so somebody's standing up for to-do list, good.
So, for me, if I put everything on a list, it allows me to devote 100% of my attention to what I have at hand. And so, as something pops up, you know, when something pops up, oh, don't forget to do that, don't forget to do that. I put it on the list. Now I don't have to have it in the back of my mind, don't forget. And so it goes on the list, and then I'm back 100% again, you know, on that thing. And of course, prioritizing the list, what you have to do, because things do have higher priority than others.
Yeah.
You know, at work. But it's a great tool.
Yeah. Yeah, so let me respond to tomorrow. That's excellent. I totally agree with you. And I think what you said was most important, which was your to-do list is a tool to help manage the day and the things you need to do better, so you can not be carrying these things around in your mind and be focusing on one. I totally agree with you. I make to-do lists. Okay, so I'm glad you brought that up. This was not a rant against to-do lists. This was about reducing our life to to-do lists and accomplishing to-do lists and make them sources of pressure. Right. If to-do lists ease the pressure, ease the stress, and kind of, yeah, that's, yeah, yes. And these are just tools. I'm just saying that the opposite, okay? You know, for many people, it's no longer a tool. It's what it's all about. So good. I'm glad you balance things a bit. I appreciate that. So good. On that practical note, we will end our discussion for the day. Thank you.